Welcome to the PAC Show. It's a show that brings you all the highlights, the lowlights, the reviews, the previews, the news, and the interviews from rugby here in Australia and around the world. My name is Jay Bourne. Joining us tonight, we have Doss. We also have Dallin. And then we've got the Battlers. Unfortunately, they have both shown up tonight. It's Big Fat Darce and the Kill Switch himself.
With the vest of friends.
All right, Darce, shut your face, because joining us all the way from Wallabies camp, it's Samu Krebi. Samu. It's Jono Lands. Grace Hamilton, everybody. Damon Murphy, Super Rugby referee. We have got Jed Holloway on the blower. We've been raving for about a month now that we have to get the best player from the Tars on the blower, and unfortunately Tate Edmund was unavailable.
Alex, you've obviously forged your own path. You know, you represented Australia in the Sevens. You played for the Queensland Reds. How special is it for you to watch your little brother, who you've gone through with so much, how special is it to see him and succeed and achieve the goals that he wants to achieve it, and ultimately represent his country?
It makes me super proud. You know, going through my rugby career with my brother was always really special. You never give up and you keep trying, and it's good to see him there, so he does deserve it.
Yeah, it was a special night, it was a special week, and one I won't remember. I will remember.
My highlight would probably be like being able to play 100 tests for Australia. To me, that was really special because Everybody says you never expect to play one, but you never do. The one thing I remember the most, when I went to score that try, like when I made the break and went downfield, like that roar, I've never heard anything like that before.
It was so good.
Like it was deafening.
Welcome to the very last episode for season one of the PAC Show. We are doing something crazy today. We have changed the games. We are bringing you the QPR President's 15 versus the Reds Development 15, simulcast alongside the Reds broadcast. We have Dallin alongside him, Benny Lucas. We've got Doss mic'd up, running water. Well, there we go. We've got Doss right in the middle of that huddle right there, actually. What's the word going on in the huddle there for the President's 15?
Pat Murray, he was pretty vocal in that one, and he wasn't in the last two.
He's joining us right on the blower right now from Clubland. Sweeney, how are ya?
Hey, boys, I'm good. How are you?
Boys, I tell you what, like, bad day to be a beer, isn't it?
Mate, who wins the Caulfield Cup?
Very good question. I'm going to be watching that very shortly. Knights Order wins the Caulfield Cup.
Knights Order. All right, perfect. I'm on.
Yeah, boys, I'm here with probably the best Lucas, the best of the bunch. What do you guys need to do now to, you know, fight back in the second half and maybe cause an upset?
Limit the penalties, number one.
Yeah.
But then just keep the ball.
Mate, go with the team. Go hard second half.
From Channel 9, we've got sports reporter Michael Atkinson.
You guys got a real Eli Peyton Manning thing going on here. I'm a big fan of it.
He gets it.
Mate, David, first half, all the count is about 11-1. What were the President's 15 doing, in your opinion?
Just rocking
the
fixtures,
mate. The boys are watching and they're happy for the moment. And mate, your thoughts on this whole concept?
Oh, mate, it's awesome. It's good for us too, mate. Like, I know we always forget about the referees, but it's good for us to do some high-level stuff too. Like,
referees always need to have their voice, don't they? Always need to be heard, these bastards.
there you go, boys.
Here with the 5-8 for the President's 15 today, Taylor Adams. J-Ball, mate, don't get too excited in studio.
Tell him I love him.
J-Ball wants to let you know that he loves you. But, mate, notice on film. Hang on, we've got Seth and Dizzy. Come over here. Oh, hang on, boys. I wanted to bring these guys on camera to make me feel a lot better about myself.
But we'll leave you to it and have an awesome afternoon. It looks like it's going to be a belter afterwards.
Awesome, thanks, boys. As I said, like this, I think what we're doing, it's brilliant. I hope it gets received well. I mean, you know, what we're bringing to the game, it's definitely something different. You know, I hope the higher powers, they can see value in what we're doing. We're all in this together. We're just trying to grow this beautiful game of rugby. And I think this aspect to it is something that hasn't been explored at all yet. So hopefully, you know, we're entering some groundbreaking territory, and it's something that, you know, we can do more consistently.
Yeah! Yeah. There it is, the wrap-up of season one of the PAC Show. But here we are live right now from the DoubleTake Studios, bringing you season two of the all-new PAC Rugby Show. My name's Jay Bourne, and I am fizzing at the bunghole for season two. It's going to be absolutely immense. And coming back to join us, we don't have a full contingent tonight, but we do have Dallin on the starters bench. Round of applause for Dallin. Unfortunately, Dossie couldn't make it tonight, but the big horse will be back. That said, our battlers back once again. We had the kill switch and we had big fat ass. Yeah.
The boys.
All right, thanks, J-Ball.
Yeah, the boys. Yeah. Absolutely massive stuff this season. We have so much planned for this season. It's going to be bigger and better than it was last year. And that's going to be pretty hard to top. But to start things off, just to announce it tonight, joining us live from TARS HQ, not one but two of the sexiest men in rugby union, we have Charlie Gamble and Mark Nawaqanitawase. We're going to be going across all the news that's happened, Eddie Jones, Taniela Tupo, all this sort of stuff. We've also got a new tipping segment, which is going to be pretty feisty, I think. The Battler's Bench, big fat darts. He's got a few things planned.
And friends. He did his homework too.
I do my homework.
Yeah.
He is
did
here.
Did you actually do your homework?
Yeah, I did.
No.
Yeah.
Well, he is here, but tonight's going to be absolutely massive. And to kick it off, we're going to get straight into it. Dow, we may as well just dive in head first. The news overnight was announced that Taniela Tupou signing a multi-million dollar contract to stay with Rugby Australia, but no longer with the Reds. Huge.
Well, it's massive, isn't it? Obviously, he's been a large part of Queensland since he got here as a 17, 18-year-old. Obviously, with the injury happening in the last, 6 months, it's been tough on him. But, greener pastures, and it looks like he's heading down south. But I think the key part here is it's exciting that Rugby Australia have locked him in for the next couple of years by the sounds.
It's funny you say that, because Tino went through the archives in our first episode last year. Literally, the first thing we discussed on PAC News was in regards to the...
Looks like I went on greener pastures there.
Yeah, you're looking pretty good. Let's throw back and have a quick look at the first episode last year.
Oh, this is a big one. Nella, Taniela Tupou, we saw on the weekend, down to 7, steps up, fists the Tars, scores a try. Apparently his manager is out there chasing $1 million a season for him. Dow, is he worth it? Is he worth $1 million to stay in the game in Queensland and Australia?
Wholeheartedly. I feel like you pay the man, whatever you need to do.
Scores,
to retain
tries,
him.
Flick passes, deletes blokes on both sides of the ball.
Correct. So he's a once-in-a-generation player for me. So he is like nothing we've ever seen before, especially in Australian rugby.
Clearly didn't watch any of my games, so that's cool. Go on.
In that position. But beyond that, he's only still young. He's only going to develop. But he's the type of guy, he's a homebody. And doesn't necessarily want to leave the country. And so the only reason he leave the country is for money. So let's try and pay him what it is to keep him here.
100%.
I want to go back, J-Ball. If his manager's only asking for $1 million a season, Taniela needs to think about coming over to my mate here, because he'll get him a lot more than that.
Yes, yes.
You hear me, Tongenthor?
Hell yeah. While we're at it, Dow, what can we do to get paid for doing this shit? Because 2 years later, and I'm still using a rope on my pants.
We haven't figured that bit out, but
We still haven't figured that bit out.
Dow.
Picked it. Like a dirty nose.
Absolutely. Out of nowhere.
I don't know if I picked it. I think it was, exactly what had to happen if you want to keep a man like that who is so destructive and is, so exciting. You know what I mean? We want to keep him here in Australia. We want to keep as many players in Australia as possible. So it's a great coup for the game, and it's excellent then to know that Taniela is staying with Rugby Australia.
What about moving to the Rebels, though? What from the Reds' perspective, how does that look for them, do you think? And then obviously for the Rebels, how does it look for them?
Well, it's a big loss for Queensland. Mm. Do you know what I mean? Obviously, he's a cornerstone and something that they've developed over, the last 10 years. He's been there for that long, and it's a huge, loss for them in that tight head spot. They've got some developing guys, but he's a Wallaby starter and someone who's got a huge future in the game still. And then from a Rebels perspective, it's immense. We talked about it last year. It was either Samu. Do you know what I mean? He would have been a massive get for them, but I think Samu probably makes a bigger difference to the team. But getting someone like Taniela is just enormous. They've got a wonderful front row as it stands. He just brings a bit of X factor and brings that, eyes now on Melbourne.
That's it, the eyes. We've spoken about it. We spoke about it all last year as well. Friends, we were talking about the fact that you've got guys like Nella. They're the guys we need to be promoting. They're the guys who get bums on seats. Now, he's going to maybe one of the markets that clearly they're trying to promote. You've got the 100%. Super Round that's going there. They play test matches there. Like, it's an underdeveloped market that could really thrive with someone like Nella.
Big time as well, and it'd be good for Melbourne Rugby not just, to get eyes on rugby down there, but also to try and develop the grassroots and stuff. And, instead of guys coming from Melbourne up here to play their rugby, hopefully one day they can play their Premier Rugby down in Melbourne. And you know what I mean?
It'll be absolutely huge. But speaking of huge, we saw, we won't get your opinion on this, Dust. Don't worry about it. You can sit back.
What will the doggies do?
Oh, yeah, you never know, mate.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, well, don't they say once you get a Rebels jersey, you also get a doggies jersey. So, but we're just sort of ticking off the big news over the off-season. And obviously, just a few weeks ago, massive. Rennie gets the sack, Eddie Jones in. Another thing, we don't have the clip of it, but another thing we actually sort of discussed last year was whether he was going to get the arse before he gets punted. But your thoughts, Big Fat Das, we'll get your thoughts on it. Thoughts on Eddie Jones coming back to the Wallabies, good, bad or otherwise?
You know, obviously it's a shame that Rennie left this close to a World Cup, but the excitement factor, the talking about the game, just the confidence that Eddie Jones brings to the game. Look at, like, even on the media, newspaper, he's on the news.
We were on the rugby was on the Today Show.
It was, like, right? That hasn't happened for 10 years.
And that's bloody fantastic.
It is. And just having fantastic. Eddie Jones just coming in and he's just doing what Eddie does, and let's just see what happens. I'm excited.
It is huge. Like, it's a bit of a weird one. It's almost like it's the same thing that happened at the 2015 World Cup with Michael Checker. I took over a side that was really starting to develop under Ewan McKenzie and then was able to galvanise them quickly to get to the World Cup final.
Absolutely.
Do you think, Freens, it could be the same thing? Rennie was developing this.
Oh, there we go.
We're going to win it. Eddie's bringing it back. We're going to win it.
You reckon?
It's coming home.
Marky Mark's going to score the try that wins it for us.
Hell yeah. Yeah. Speaking of Marky Mark, here we go. Let's kick it to him over at Tars HQ. We've got Mark Nawaqanitawase and Charlie Gamble. Yeah, the boys.
Hey, boys.
How are you, fellas?
Good, thanks. How are you?
Oh, I'm living the dream over here. Charlie, I just want to kick things off first and foremost, mate. Let's address the big fat elephant in the room, right? It's your eligibility. There's so much talk about it. You're the hottest man in a Tars jersey. We want to know, are you single? Are you seeing someone? Are you...
Boys, let's do it. My status. Watching me. Could get in trouble here. But, no, I'm taken. Happily taken. So, yeah, I'll leave it at this. Oh, no, I better not leave it at this
guy. Hey!
Could get him in trouble.
Sorry. Well, are you blushing, Marky?
Oh, we got off to a feisty start. This is good gas. But no, but honestly, in all honesty, both of you guys absolutely crushing it. We know a couple years ago the Tars got a duck egg. Was it none for 15 or something like that after the Super Rugby season? Then last year, absolutely turned it around and killing it off the back of guys like yourself. Mark, being a young fella coming into the squad and then starting to solidify yourself so much so that you got a Guernsey for the Wallabies later on in the year. How does it feel to be a part of something that seems to be pretty special under DC?
Yeah, it's, obviously, you know, it's been pretty fun. You know, last year we had a great year and, you know, I guess that kind of is building for this this year. You know, we're excited to get down this Friday, obviously round one versus the Brumbies. But, you know, there's a... Like you said, there's a good vibe around here and we're all very keen to, you know, see where we can get to, you know, how far we can get to.
DC set a theme last year was, you know, you guys are rocky, you know, you were out there and you were kind of in the boondocks and in, you know, the sheds that you guys had. Now you got this wonderful new facility and you're Ivan Drago. Like, talk to me about the mentality that he has and, you know, what it means for you guys. Obviously, second year under him, but now in this wonderful facility, how's the mindset changed?
Yeah, I guess, obviously, when DC came in, you know, he's obviously taken us from a season where we hadn't won any games to... You know, we were the underdogs. This year's a little bit different. As you said, we've got some new facilities that are, you know, top-notch, world-class. You know, we can't change our mindset around that. We've been working pretty hard. You know, 12, 13 weeks. Pre-season's been pretty tough. So, you know, we've got the same mentality. We're obviously, the teams are a bit wary. They're not too sure how we're going to play this year. We know we've got lots of threats around the field. And I think we play a style of rugby that, you know, Australia pretty keen to watch and just the rugby public in general.
Marky, Big Fat Das, senior co-chair of the Battlers bench, mate. season 2021 into 2022, you must have put on 10 kilos of mass and you've done it again. Friends and I, we've been doing it nonstop for the last 5 years, just bulking up for the last 5-6 years. Do you have any tips for us? How do we, is it all KFC? Because that's what we tend to be doing. We do dirty bulking. How do you do it, mate?
If I was honest with you, dirty bulk's the way to go.
Yes, I knew it. We were honest up the front.
That's beautiful. And talking about the bulk there, Marky, I see Max Jorgensen on the other wing. Have you guys had a runoff yet? Who's faster?
Oh. He's pretty nippy, the little one, but we haven't had a full race yet, I'm not too sure.
Humble? I reckon humble. That could be a bit of a content piece for you guys.
Potentially.
Yeah, let's get the boys down there, film that. That'd be red hot. But speaking of the young fella, Mark, like you, I touched on it before. You've sort of come through the same system. You were only young when you sort of got your blue jersey. We saw Max Jorgensen just a couple of weeks ago in Narrabri stitch up, of all people Filippo at not an easy thing to do. I mean, there's huge raps on him, and I mean, he's taking to it pretty bloody well, isn't he?
Yeah, he sure is. Obviously, you know, like you said, he's done well in his first few trial games. But yeah, mate, like just around the training paddock and even off the field, like the way he carries himself, like he's got a good head on his shoulders, and you know, he's very talented. And I guess as he goes along, the more confidence he gets, I guess the more talent he'll show. But yeah, he's exciting to watch, and you know, super pumped to see how he goes this Friday.
And for you, Charlie, you've got, I'm sure a lot of people already know it, but you've got a pretty crazy story in regards to how you found your way into the blue of the Waratahs, coming out of New Zealand into club rugby, no, subbies rugby, into club and then into it. Like, I mean, it's pretty crazy. Just how, like, run us through the transition that you've had to go through from coming from Kiwi club rugby all the way up into a Tars jersey.
Yeah, I guess, first of all, like, my move to Australia wasn't kind of for my rugby. Like, I just wanted to start a new life and move over and, you know, just enjoy just life with my partner and, you know, do all the touristy stuff. You know, one thing led to another. I started playing down at Petersham, the subbies competition, you know, just having a bit of fun down there with the boys. And, yeah, I guess that just brought a lot of excitement back into my rugby. And, you know, I just kind of started loving it again because there was a bit of time there where, you know, I wasn't loving my rugby. So, yeah, then went from Petersham to Eastern Suburbs and Shoe Shield, and then just, I guess, got picked up there from Tars, and here I am 4 years later still.
I love how you go on tour to play a bit of footy and you end up in a Tars jersey. We do it, we end up with gout and liver disease. So, this dude, man.
And, Mark, for you, obviously probably different scenarios. This time last year, you weren't a Wallaby. You know, now you are. Do you feel any more pressure, or has your mindset changed? Do you feel like you need to be, you know, more consistent out there? How's your kind of preseason been?
Oh, I guess not really a mindset change. More so, or like you said, a consistency is part of your, I guess, your whole career. Not just, you know, if you're in one team or another, you kind of want to be consistent the whole time. And I guess not really pressure, but the Wallabies thing kind of gives you more confidence, I guess, I feel. And I'd like to bring that into, I guess, this season at the Tars and, you know, see where I can go to with that. So, yeah, definitely no pressure, just more so confidence, trying to take it out there and have some fun.
Charlie, mate, Danny Glover, Tom Selleck, Cliffy Lyons, all have very powerful mows. Who do you reckon your inspo for your moustache is, mate?
I don't know. I'm kind of stuck with it.
Oh, you're stuck?
Yeah.
It's powerful.
I would have thought you watched a bit of porno from the 70s.
This one for Charlie. I know that you've got a bit of tongue and blood in you, mate. If Uncle Eddie doesn't get you up for the Wallabies, you want to come over to Tonga?
Hey, depends who's asking, eh?
Tote just messaged me, actually. Thank you. He said to me, you'll come to Tonga, we give you a free puaka. So you come over there, we have some beers and eat some pig, okay?
Just Just touching on that though. Obviously, Eddie coming in, he seems to be in and around all of the Super Rugby trials. Have you guys touched base with him? Has he reached out to everyone? You know, what have those conversations been like?
Well, funny that he was actually in today, but that's my first time meeting him today at training. Just said hello and nice to meet you, kind of thing. But yeah,
hey, Dad.
Literally, but. he's spoken to him more than me.
Oh. Hey! I knew it.
Don't worry about bloody Tonga, mate. Say in Australia.
Oh man, yeah, he's spoken to him more than myself. So he's obviously been around, and I guess he's got a busy schedule, so he's got a few plays to see before I guess us. But it's interesting.
And DC been putting his hand up for the attack role?
Mate, he put his hand up for anything.
Oh, you're done.
Don't worry, it's not live. No, but seriously, Charlie, if the tap came on the shoulder from Eddie Jones, like you're eligible this year, I believe. Like, obviously, there's a lot to weigh up. Obviously, the Tongan heritage from New Zealand, being here, plying your trade in Australia for the better part of half a decade. What would happen if Eddie did give you the tap on the shoulder and have a yarn and just say, do you want to come to the World Cup with us?
Yeah, that's no question. I'd definitely say yes. Like you said, I've been here 5 years now, and, I've always grown up being... as a kid trying to play professional rugby, and the Tars are the first one to, give that to me, and, owe them a lot. And I just sold a lot to Rugby Australia, Australian rugby in general.
See you in Parramatta again, mate. A bunch of face.
I'm shaking the head watching this.
Oh, no, seriously, there's about eight guys in here who just cream their pants here and that. That's really good gas, because it's the standard of footy you've brought to the Tars is absolutely awesome, and I think it's just a testament to obviously yourself, but what DC's building there. And on DC, it's well documented that he loves the social side of things, but he's very much about the culture, and he's discussed previously about linking what seemed to be a disconnect between the club rugby in Sydney to obviously the professional side at the Tars. And Charlie, I'll get your opinion on this, because you've come through literally from the subbies all the way up to the Tars. Has there been a really distinct, at least conversation, or is there a real distinct shift from DC and what he's brought in to be able to really bring that connection and make sort of New South Wales rugby whole again?
Yeah, I guess the good thing about DC, he's kind of made his way up the ranks as well, hasn't he? He's made those connections all through club rugby and Shoot Shield, and... he's had to prove himself. He said he had a role here at the Tars 20-odd years ago and they booted it. So, he's had to start from the bottom, and he's shown with his record. Most teams that he's gone to, he's won a premiership. To have a coach coming like that with that kind of record, it's something that you just want to buy into straight away. And, culture is definitely a big thing here. And, everyone loves DC. He just gets it. When it's time to be on, it's on. But when it's time to, have a bit of socials or have a couple of beers together, he's on there as well. So, he's a legend.
Yeah, just ask Friends. Friends loves him.
Yeah, we're talking tactics certainly, during Aqua. That's good.
Yeah, I'm sure
good
you
game
were.
Plan. Good game plan.
I'm
for
sure
this
you
year,
were, mate. But, he comes from a... he's got a weird perspective on things. Evident by the fact that just a week or two ago, he got everybody to sleep out in a swag in the middle of Allianz Stadium. That's weird unto itself, but does he have quirks that he brings into his coaching side of things, from the actual tactics side, Mark? Is there something just a bit weird about him when he comes to his coaching, or is it pretty down the line with it?
He'd be pretty down the line with it. Like Charlie said before, he's pretty on when he's on. Just with his rugby stuff, he's pretty, he's got a great knowledge, a wide variety of things he likes to do in attack. He's pretty straightforward, I guess. Nothing crazy.
Nice. save that for off the pitch, eh?
One thing I'm really excited about is seeing the partnership between Tane Edmed and Ben Donaldson. Obviously, both, you know, genuine 10s. How are they working together, Mark, you know, in that 10 and 15 space? Has it opened up your game at all?
Yeah, definitely. It's always good to, I guess, have, you know, both players on the field. Both of them can, you know, both of them are quality players. So it's, you know, it's good to see when they're around. They can, you know, two ball players on the field at the same time. So I kind of gets the ball moving, helps our forwards out quite a bit. You know, they don't know what they're doing half the time, but it's good because, yeah. Like,
spent all that money on the new facilities, couldn't get a microphone stand. Fair enough. There we go.
There we go. Good framing.
Yeah, so I was saying, they're working well together at the moment, you know, especially in those roles. But yeah, it's good to see some ball on the edge. So yeah,
how did Big Nemsy go in pre-season when it was nice and hot, not used to the old French or English weather?
Has he even trained?
Boy, shots fired, mate. He was glistening out at Narrabri. Eh? Yeah. Like, I was like,
looks like he's quite fit.
he's lost some weight.
Yeah. He has, but mate, he is still so big man. Boy, I was just like, oh, mate. Good to see he's still absolutely juicy. But similar question for you, Charlie. Obviously, Michael Hooper, he stood down from the Aussie role last year just for his own mental health, but he seems to be back now. He's actually said he'd be keen to take over the captain's armband in the Wallabies if it obviously was on offer. But someone of his ilk, someone of his like credentials, to be able to play not only alongside him but to be mentored underneath him, that must be absolutely huge for your game.
Yeah, mate, like Hoops is one of the best sevens to ever play the game. I grew up, you know, watching him. He's been playing professional rugby since he was about 18 years old. So, you know, to make it over here and obviously sign with the Tars and to be under him for, you know, 4 years and learn as much as I can, it's just awesome. I try to pick his brains as much as possible and he does the same back. I think we complement each other really well. And he's just a good bloke in general. So, yeah, it's good to be with him, and you know, he's ready to have a big year.
Right on, bloody oath. Well, one last question for both of you individually. Mark, start with you. What do you want? Like, what is your goal for the remainder of 2023? Is it obviously come home with the World Cup? But for you personally, what would you really want?
Well, at the moment, obviously, I'd love to win a Super Rugby comp. You know. Here at the Tars, like you said at the start, it's really good vibes at the moment, and you know, we're feeling confident. So we'd really like to, or I personally, and I, you know, the majority of us would really like to, you know, make it to the grand final one day and hopefully take it out. So yeah.
Hell yeah, love to hear it. And Charlie, yourself, mate, 2023 set to be a big one for you. Like, what are you chasing for this year?
Yeah, mate, I'm exactly the same as Marky. Good buzz around here. The boys put on a lot of work. We want to win that title. You know, it's gonna take a lot from us. We've got to take it step by step. But yeah, I got full confidence in this group and the depth and the coaching. You know, it's time for us to stop talking and we've actually got to put our actions in. So we can't wait to hook in this Friday and see where it takes us.
Oh mate, I'm loving it. I am so pumped. I am massively erect underneath this desk. Boys, Mark Nawaqanitawase, Charlie Gamble, thank you so much for joining us. All the best this Friday night and all the best for the rest of the season.
Yeah, the
cheers,
boys.
Cheers, lads. Yeah, round of applause. Marky Mark and Charlie Gamble. Boys.
Thank you.
Legit the two hottest guys in Aussie rugby.
Yeah. Actually proven in our survey last week on the podcast. Gorgeous.
I thought you were about to say five. Just in this room. I was like, yeah, probably.
Just in my
own little poll. absolutely awesome stuff there. That the best. I saw you get a big smile on your face, Dow, when I said, "Oh yeah, you know, take home the World Cup, all this shit." And Mark just went, "You know, personally, first and foremost, it's just let's win the Super Rugby title. Like, no what? Big heads, no, like they're not clouded by ego. Clearly, it's just
what a squad." What a squad, too. Look at the guys on the bench.
Back
like,
row
like
is angry.
Lungy Gleeson on the bench.
Will Harris on the bench.
Yeah, and Nems on the bench.
Oh, mate.
Imagine trying to stop him in the bloody 60th minute. Big Namzy off the bench, just fresh as.
Brutal, eh?
Boost.
I think, to be honest, I think Mark did lie to us. I don't think he's dirty bulking the way we are. I don't think he's hitting up the drive-through.
Nah. He probably goes to the gym a bit more than us, I reckon, man.
Yeah,
man,
dirty bulk.
That can't be it. There
dirty
be
bulk for him
fix.
Is he has white rice with his plain chicken.
Man, he's that'd be actually a good race, him and Jorgensen.
I reckon.
That needs to be a thing.
Jorgensen.
But I reckon Jorgo would have him, mate. He is.
I don't know. He's got that long. Like, he'd have him over 20, and then Marky Mark's coming home strong.
I think, Tino, we've got to get you down to Sydney to film the boys. Yeah. That's a good
with
little content
drone,
piece.
Just don't get stuck on the roof again.
We can't. Hold on. We can't. What happened?
Okay, Tino's giving us the hurry along, said. That said, we'll tick off the last couple little bits of PAC news before we actually get into a little content piece the boys got down to the TARS Media Day. But before we get into that, big news as well, speaking of the TARS, we didn't even touch on it, but Angus Bell.
Oh,
huge
yes.
signing for a multi-year deal to sign not only with the TARS but with Rugby Australia. Friends, you're the front rower here and you just jizzed in your pants. Yeah. Like, that's
absolutely
massive.
He's a complete loosehead. He's massive. He's good around the park. He's a great scrummager and a good bloke. So,
and only in his early 20s. Like, you think of most props coming of age, late 20s.
Yeah.
He's still, and he's
yeah, it's true.
Holds his own.
Yeah, yeah.
He
yeah.
holds his own now, and so he might start to lose a little bit of the ball running and that he has now. But yeah.
he'd be like a slipper, mate. Imagine how good he would be at 30.
Yes, yeah. exactly, mate. Insane. Like, he will be absolutely fantastic, and that's a signing that. It's just huge.
It was a good chat down in Sydney when I saw him and I was talking. I was like, who's the hardest tight head prop you've ever scrummed against? And he was like that Malherb from South Africa.
Malherb,
just a big South African Afrikaans farmer and just didn't say anything. Just minced, like, just hanging on for dear life.
Oh, mate, bloody good gas. And then the last thing, Dallin, something we've waxed lyrical about all last year. We seem to have our finger on the pulse when it comes to things. The women. Finally, there has been a commitment that they will be, all of them being paid by, I think it was 2025.
Yeah.
So by 2025, all Super W players, I think minimum will make a $5,000 wage up to 30 or something. And then obviously the Wallaroos will all be contracted. That's absolutely huge. And it's a massive step in the right direction for the women's game or the game as a whole, really.
Oh, it's enormous. And obviously, it's something that we've discussed immensely over the last couple of years. And I'm just so happy that it's happened. You know what I mean? It's starting to follow trend. It's starting to happen all around the world. We also saw the female IPL that's just happened recently. Like, I can see that starting to happen, which is, you know, perfect. And it's exactly what should be happening. For the game here, it just allows us to strengthen our position.
100%.
Yeah. You know what I mean? You look what the women's sevens can do with that full endorsement, that full ability to earn money and train full time. That's only a matter of years away. Now, by that 2026 World Cup for the women, whatever it ends up being, do you know what I mean? They'll be absolutely humming. And I just think it's just reward for them, and it's about time.
Mm. Especially with all the, you know, there's a lot of young girls playing rugby these days, and by the time, you know, it's fully contracted and they're getting paid, like, you know, that depth hopefully will be there. Then the girls that have gone from union to league, hopefully, I reckon they'll come back. I reckon they'll come back.
100%.
They will.
Because the opportunities you get in rugby are just so much, it's vaster, right?
Well, even the girls in England at
correct.
The moment.
They're going over there having that experience. You know what I
mean? What, you don't want to play in a Rugby League World Cup in Manchester against Lebanon? Come on, man.
But it just becomes a lot more attractive to them as well. And you can be dual code almost. You can play sevens, you can play for the 15s. Yeah. Charlotte Castlick's put her hand up to be a part of that 15 setup now, you know, moving forward. So it's exciting.
Yeah, 100%.
It's just it's a better game.
It is a better game.
Just got to get the girls some more footy.
Yep.
Especially those bloody Wallaroos. And hopefully with this Wallaroo contracting, that means they'll get them playing more games.
The Waratahs women, they went over to New Zealand on the weekend.
Yeah, playing
Chiefs
the RPK.
And Chiefs and Blues.
Yep.
Yeah. So that was awesome.
Yeah.
Absolutely
those Kiwi
awesome.
Girls can play, bloody hell.
But the thing is, there's three or four Aussie Sheilas playing in the for the Chiefs and the Blues as well. So, like, clearly, as Dow said, like, the rest of the world has done so. Now we can actually set our mark within that space. Absolutely awesome stuff. That rounds out PAC news. That said, as we touched on just before with Big Tino, the boys were able to get down last week to TARS HQ for the media day, and they had a yarn to a few of the blokes. And we sent down a new roving reporter. It is Joey Lala. So let's see what Joey got up to.
Well, we've interviewed the people in the streets. Well, they don't know too much about the Waratahs, so we found ourselves here at Tars HQ, and we're going to interview the players and get to know them a little bit more, and so you get to know a bit more about your team. Come on.
Don't know when it's knocker, I only do it proper. Gang like coppers, all change when we rock up. The tourists in the meat, but I ain't talking big popper like a high-speed chase. I follow
to MTV Crips. As you can see, this is my flower garden, and at the front of my flower garden, we like to have, obviously, because it's the name, the Waratahs, we have a couple of nice, beautiful Waratah flowers out here. Over to my right over here, my right, your left. We have the Tars actually on the field at the moment. They're getting ready, warming up. But why don't we go have a look at the facility, shall we? Making our way down the hallway. We also have the change rooms in here. That's good. So could you just tell us a bit about this room that we have here?
It's the Waratahs change room, the actual physical team. I'm Terry Woodward. I'm the Waratahs Logistics and Facilities Manager. It's solely designated to them. No one else uses it.
Yeah, amazing. And how long have you been here for, Terry?
A long, long time.
Do you have a locker here?
No, I don't.
They ask you how you are, you just have to say that you're fine.
People at home, Terry needs a locker too. Terry's life matters. So if you just joined us again, I've been looking for my mate and I'm looking for his locker. He usually plays wing. So if you're a winger, you're usually 11 or 14. And I'm looking around, I can't see his name on any of these lockers. And then I realize that they actually gave him a locker number that suits his age. My guy, Nemani Ndolo.
Damn.
Let's have a look at his locker here. Let's see what he's got. This is how you know you've made it. Mans is really out here traveling with a Louis Vuitton bath bag. And let's see what he's got inside here. Wet cake? Out here smelling like $1 million, Nemzy. There's a thing in the islands, all right? We're all related somehow, so I'm sure as family, he won't mind me just trying on some of his kit. So we got a jersey here. Be rude not to. The man in Ndolo, good na Eagles. Sorry, introduce yourself. What's your name?
Yeah, Harry Johnson Holmes.
Harry Johnson Holmes. That's a mouthful.
Yeah.
Harry.
I've been told that.
Wow.
What's going on?
No, not much, brother. We're just currently here in the change rooms. Tell me about whereabouts is your locker?
Mate, 29, the mayor's office.
Now, I'm not too sure if you know this, but rumour has it is that you are the man that they go to for a good pep talk.
Oh, all the time.
You got words of wisdom?
I'm leaking words of wisdom. People don't listen normally, but this is my medium now.
All right, well, brother, this is your time to shine. I want you to look dead down the barrel. You're down by 5 points, and you've got a scrum inside the 40. What are your words to your team?
Down by five.
You're down by five, and there's 30 seconds to go.
Oh, so we're up against it. Boys, yeah. It's moments like these. You might think it's character building, but at the end of the day, it's character revealing. Character defining.
Yeah.
I see those 5 points up on the board. We're down. I see it as an opportunity. You're thinking the back's against the wall. I'm thinking their back's against the wall. The only thing that's stopping us from winning the game is ourselves. The only thing that they would rather right now is to be up by more than a converted try. I see 5 points on the board. I see opportunity. Dig the feet in. 16 feet in. You got studs for a reason. Come on, boys. That's where we go.
We're to get to know some of our favourite Waratahs players.
That's good.
Yeah, Joey Lala bringing the heat. That was awesome. Harry Johnson Holmes, I don't know about you guys, but I'd run through a brick wall for that big ginger, eh?
Gorgeous.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. Oh, that was feisty. I got goosebumps just thinking about it. Yeah. Speaking about goosebumps, the anticipation is killing me.
No.
It's now time for the Battler's Bench. Take it away, Big Fat Dars.
Oh, thanks, J-Boy. We just thought that as of last year, J-Boy, this is actually in regards to you. You came up with a very bold prediction last year that if the West Bulldogs do not, you looked down the barrel of the camera and you said, if the West Bulldogs do not win the comp, I'm going to shave my beard or
Hold
your
up.
Head.
Just real quick, Zachy Boy, roll the footage, please.
Oh, he's got it.
But mate, no, that actually goes to, like, I've been talking to a couple of guys and they're like, Elby is like, he's not taking shit. Diego gets left at the door. He's toughening them up and it's showing. Like, it is showing. And that win is the
catalyst. Still not going to win the premiership.
No.
What do you reckon? The East will?
They'll be top four.
If Wes, we got Wes, East, Brothers, Jeeps, and Wes over there.
Yeah.
whatever team doesn't win the premiership, like West are going to win it, so you guys have to do something. If they, if West don't win it, I will unironically shave a goatee for the remainder of the year.
Just a chin strap, no moustache.
You got to go clean shaven.
Clean shaven. Okay, I will go if the Doggies don't win. I'll go clean shaven
for a month.
And we glue your beard hair on top of your head. For a photo. For a photo.
What? No, if West win, you have to bleach blonde your hair.
Oh. Yes.
Peroxide blonde.
Just froth.
Yes.
Same with you, Doss, and same with you, Freeze.
No problems, I'll do it now.
All right, well, Freeze, I don't know what you're going to do. Yeah, what do we do for Freeze then?
Can't do anything.
Deal? 100%. The Doggies are going to win it. They're going to go two better than they did last year. I'm pretty sure I heard people say all right.
Well, on the win.
Blonde hair either.
Well, technically, because that does not make it contractual. So what we're going to do in this segment is look straight down the barrel of the camera and give our bold prediction for Super Rugby Pacific Season 2023. However, if it's not bold enough, we're going to veto it, okay?
Okay.
So Friends and I have come up with some. We've come up with some that would not quite make it. It's not quite as bold as it should be. My first one is...
You've got to look down the barrel of the camera.
Oh, this,
we got new cameras that can zoom
we
in.
We do.
hold up.
Season 2023. Super Rugby Pacific Season 2023. My unbold prediction is that my Stan account will falter yet again and I will not be able to watch any Super Rugby this year like I did last year. That one would not be bold enough.
Or...
My other one is that Bomber the Dog will be brought back yet again.
What, for Reds games?
Yep.
The T-Dog.
The T-Dog.
Jeez, I hope this gets better. Yep.
Oh. and some young Kiwi winger will be labelled the next Jonah Lomu.
Is that it?
That would not be.
So they're the unbold.
Yes, correct.
Oh, so they're so steer clear of that.
Yes.
Okay.
So you would hold up.
Oh, what? No. Okay. Okay.
Your down three. The barrel of the camera. Your camera's up here, number three. Hold up. It's going to zoom in.
Now. This year, Fiji draw, they're going to get to the semi-finals. You get it?
Are you doing your unbold ones?
Oh, no, I didn't have unbold. You just did your bold predictions. Do you want to read the message?
Do you know what my sixth one was? It was... Freddie will disappoint me by not doing any of his homework.
Well, I've done half.
Said that you did.
I've done half the assignment. You never told me I'm bold. You told me bold.
I don't know. I don't even know.
We're off to a good start.
J-Ball, can you please give your serious bold prediction for season?
My bold prediction for season 2023 is that the Waratahs will play in a losing grand final.
Ooh. I actually had one for that, and they're going to win it.
Oh, well, you didn't read any of them.
I read my one.
You just decided to... Read whatever, mate. Dal?
Mine's similar to Freen's.
Hold up.
But...
It's going to zoom in. Look at this. All the gear.
The Fiji Drua go undefeated at home.
Oh, yes, that's a good
one.
Is that very bold?
It's not very bold. That's pretty standard, I reckon.
Actually, because I was thinking the same thing. If three of us kind of think that they're going to be on a roll, is that bold enough?
Well, I said semi-final. I said semi-final.
So you reckon they probably... And to get there, they'd have to win every home game, you'd say.
Yep.
Oh, well, so...
Veto.
Oi, go again, Dal. On the spot. Come up with one.
Crusaders play with their right arm strapped behind the back so they don't win.
On the spot. Just be bold. Just start going. And he'll zoom in and he'll just come to you.
Down the barrel.
Next.
Come back
to
me.
No,
I'm done. Here we go. My bold prediction season 2023 is the Canterbury Crusaders will win it. Is that it?
Don't be a
dick. That's not bold enough.
Vito, you're out.
Next segment. Next segment.
My bold prediction is that the Reds will not go very well this year. Is that okay?
I hate to
say it, but not very bold, bro.
Oh!
Anyway, let's go. Next segment.
Well, you meant to read your three funny ones. Thank you, J-Ball.
Oh, round of applause for Big Fat Dars and the Battler's Bench. The look on Tino's face, man.
Every time I read them, you got up me.
Oh, God.
I'm sweating now too.
No, let's look at the positives here, right?
Yep.
One bold prediction is that the Battlers bench cannot get any shitter.
Here we go.
We've started low, guys, and the only way is up. Hey?
It's a pretty bold prediction.
Oh, there we go. Oh, that's true. That is true. Because that wasn't that bad.
That's,
is that what you're saying, Dallin?
Dallin's bold prediction.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Jesus
that's
Christ, big fat ass. It started so well and then just... Shit,
just communication breakdown. That's all it was. But we're gonna get better.
Yeah, yeah. Don't
I'm not
touch
gonna
me.
Argue like me.
Don't touch me, mate. Like I'm.
All right.
All righty. Now touching back on what some of the tipping that we had before, we're actually setting up a new in-house PAC Rugby Show tipping competition, and it's going to be the Battlers versus the Starters. So every single week, the Battlers are going to pick their Super Rugby picks for the week, and the Starters are going to pick theirs. The only difference being is it's not just win or lose. It's actually going to be in relation to the line. So they're going to put a multi on, a $10 bet, and from that, we're going to hopefully raise a bit of cash, and we want to actually send it out to the greater public. We want to ask you what we should do with any cash raised. Look, we may not raise any money. We may raise a little bit of cash, but we'd love to give it back to the people. So if it's given it to a specific club who's been down on their luck, a certain family or a player who's hit hard times, or even if it's just a local footy club, the juniors need some new footy boots, let us know what we should do with some of the cash at the end of the season, because we'd love to give back to the rugby-loving folk of Australia. So to kick things off, obviously, it starts with the first round of Super Rugby this weekend. We'll bring the lines up just there. It's a bit tough to see, but everybody is sort of picked along the same lines. The only difference being is that the Starters have selected, when it comes to the Satyrs and the Chiefs, the Satyrs, Dallin and Doss, they selected the Satyrs to get up. They're 6.5, they're 6.5-point favourites. So they're going to have to obviously get
that Chiefs side though,
point wing. And then, yeah, that Chiefs side
Chiefs
is red
hot. Side's red hot.
D-Mac at 10. And then and you guys have picked the Chiefs. So all you got to do is the Chiefs just have to lose by 6.5.
That's
really.
That's
and
the thing.
You reckon they can, guys?
I think they can keep it tight enough.
Yeah.
I think that's
I think they can score a hell of a lot of points. The only difference being the Satyrs can score a hell of a lot of points, but can also hold a lot of points out. So that could be a bit of a stinger there. And then the only difference being outside of that, the Reds and the Canes. The Battlers have gone for the Canes, but I think 3.5-point underdogs up there in Townsville. Dallin.
Oh, true.
You'd have to think
we did not
Townsville
account for
Heat
we did not account for
in
the heat.
February.
Picked the Reds,
Reds
Tino,
at home.
The wrong thing.
First game of the season.
And that's similar to what they did to the Chiefs. Was it last year or the year before? I think it's a similar scenario, and I think the Heat will be too much for them there. The boys have played two relatively good trials, the Reds, and I think they'll be too good.
Hell yeah.
It is hot up there. It is like proper hot.
But it's hot here.
Yeah.
And it's humid too. So I think the Chiefs coming out of Waikato are going to be sweating. I know the Canes.
Bloody
sorry.
Hot here.
Canes will be sweating like a fat man's asshole up there. So I think
your asshole.
We'll be sweating like my assholes. But yeah, so based on those bets, I think the estimated return for the Starters is $420, and for the Battlers, it's $465. So a bit of cash to be made if you throw a $10 bet on and you want to back the Battlers or the back the Starters. I reckon get around the boys and see what you can do, what you can bring home. And starting next week as well, every single week we're going to be throwing on just our wild multi. We're going to ride it home. We're going to get everybody to jump on board and absolutely get stuck in. So next week, Dallin's going to pick his wild multi. It's going to be three or four selections. It's going to hopefully clear about $1,000 if it comes through. But hopefully we can all ride it home. And, mate, we'll be living large off that cash. Isn't that right, Dallin?
That's right.
Are you excited for it?
100%.
Hell yeah, brother.
There he is.
Hell yeah. So, no, this year, look, we've decided we probably won't delve too much into the game and all that sort of stuff. We'll put a punt on. We'll try to discuss the games in a little bit of detail here and there. But more than anything, we want to get around the players. We want to get around just the rugby-loving folk of Australia. So if there are some awesome stories out there you think we should get out there, if there's some people that you think we should interview, we should get around, let us know. Drop it in the comments. Send us a message on Instagram, whatever it may be. We've got new socials, but we just want to grow the game here in Australia and around the world. So that's what we're doing here, and hopefully we can continue doing so in 2023. Now to round things out, we're going to kick it off, as we usually do, with our rugby. Obviously, no matches to get around this season, but we do have our rugby to watch for season 2023. And, friends, we'll start with you. You've got two. going against the grain as per usual. But it's your Uncle Penny Ravi, the new Fijian enforcer coming into the props, into prop at the Reds.
Well, we've lost Nella. We've lost that running game. We've lost that, that decent scrummager and Big Penny. He's come from France and he's ball game, a running game is ridiculous.
Massively experienced too, especially when you consider they've lost Harry Hooper.
Yep.
They've lost a lot of experience. Angus Blight's out still.
He came off the bench in the trial and he was red hot.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I reckon he's going to be a massive bolter this year. And then obviously Max Jorgensen, that trial where he skinned Filippo like two or three times is just out of control.
Yeah. Mate, he was ridiculous. And there's huge
in and away.
Raps.
It was just like proper in and away still. I was just like, this is ridiculous.
There's huge raps on Max Jorgensen. We bumped into Tim Mosey down at Narrabri and he was just like, mate, he's the trainer there now. And he was like, mate, they love him. They absolutely love Max Jorgensen. He is absolutely red hot. And then it comes out in that trial and does what he does. I mean, an 18-year-old kid comes from some good stock. His old man was a dual international in league and union. So I think...
Is he only 18?
He's 18. First year
fresh
out of school.
Out of school.
What?
Out of Joey's?
Yeah.
First year out of Joey's. And there was a highlight reel. I don't know. So from our ilk, Dal... Kirtley Beale was a year after us. Mm. We were 05, he was 06, and he was like the tits. Yeah. And
I remember seeing his Joey's.
And, mate, he was playing first in grade 9 at Joey's at fly half, and, his highlight reel was the sort of shit you now see with Max Jorgensen. And it's funny, all the comments when, oh, he just never passes a ball. I'm like,
why would you?
Yeah, why would you? I'm like, give it
why
to you,
you
deadbeat.
Why would you even walk anywhere either?
Yeah.
I'll just run everywhere.
Yeah. Mate, he is absolutely red hot. Now, Big Fat Das,
yeah, mate.
Your rugby for season 2023, none other than Hamish Stewart.
Hamish Stewart, I think big move over to the Force. He's going to have to play a big season this year, especially coming into the World Cup. I just think that if he can step up that one extra, he's so consistent and solid at 10 and at 12. I just think that if he can step up that possible Wallabies bench kind of utility spot, might open up for him. And I think that's just, I'm on him.
So you reckon that utility spot for the World Cup could be Hamish Stewart if he has a big year?
I think so.
No Kirtley Beale, obviously, in the mixer, so...
Reece Hodge has got the outside backs kind of thing, and I just think...
Well, Reece Hodge is also just signed to Bayonne, I'm pretty sure, so you never know, he might...
Yeah.
Might be on the outer in regards to the Wallabies, so that utility spot...
Kind of a Berrick Barnes kind of a player kind of thing, so yeah.
The 07 World Cup, throw him in there.
Yep.
Sweet as. Dallin, your rugby for season 2023, it's none other than Tate McDermott.
Yeah, I think Tate will be better for the second year in the captaincy role. He'll feel a little bit more comfortable. He's got a fresh start now under Eddie, and I feel like he's one year wiser. He's complete now with his game. He's kicking his passing. You know what I mean? He's going to be a big factor when it comes to the Reds and their success this year, and I think he's really ready to step up.
Do you think his captaincy with the Reds could be the thing that maybe gets him over the line in regards to... Because he's obviously Nick White, you'd say, barring any unforeseen circumstances, is your number one selection at the World Cup this year. You've got Tate McDermott and Jake Gordon, both skippers of arguably the two biggest rugby-playing states in Australia. Do you think, the fact he is captain will obviously at least put him in good stead with Jake Gordon to maybe get that reserve spot over Jake Gordon if he has a big year?
Fingers crossed.
100%, yeah.
You definitely start Nick White, and then Tate off the bench for Wallabies?
Well, it's just because being skipper, it obviously gives you that extra little bit of leadership. We saw last year, I think Jake Gordon put his hand when the Wallabies were playing. I think a couple of the guys went off the field and he went, I'm skipper, even though he came off the bench. That's obviously something Tate could probably do if, say, Alan Alatoa is off, James Slipper's off, Michael Hooper's off.
Whoever it is, yeah, absolutely.
You could bring him on the bench and know you've got a bona fide professional standard skipper.
Yeah, and someone who has that experience doing it at a high level. Obviously, it's some pressure situations, some pressure decisions to be made, so I think it puts him in good stead.
Hell yeah. And my rugby, I'm going on the other side of the ditch and going into New Zealand. I was actually going to say... Cullen Grace, because I just think a big season from Cullen Grace could sort of shoot him into the fold, but he's also got a Kiriwane, Hoskins Tutu, Marino Mateela, Tu'u, whatever the hell, down in the Landers, and then you've got Luke Jacobson. Like, it's hard for him to get in despite how bloody good he is. But someone who has probably put his hand up outside of Artie Sarve to say first picked for the All Blacks is Dalton Papali'i. The back end of last year, Friends, I know you've got a big heart on for Dalton.
Yeah.
He was absolutely immense, and by the end, he was undeniable. You needed both he and Artie Sarve on the field for the All Blacks.
And he's got that big physical presence too.
He's a huge number seven. Yep. Like, built like a six, plays like an awesome seven, but has the hands. Like, he's
silky.
He's absolutely awesome, and I think last year at the start of the season, he actually said, I want to be the best number seven in the world. And he's gone. He's gone in leaps and bounds to be able to prove that. So I think Dalton Papali'i in the back row for the Blues is going to go absolutely schizo.
I agree.
Love it.
Go absolutely schizo. So keep an eye on Dalton Papali'i because he's an absolute gun. Alrighty, well, that rounds out this the very first episode of Season 2 of the brand new PAC Rugby Show. It's been absolutely awesome. As per usual, we do tell you, go to our socials, give us a follow, give us a subscribe. You ask how you can help the show out. It means nothing to you, means everything to us. Hit that like button, hit that subscribe button on the YouTube and get all the goss as it comes out. We've got the highlights, we've got all last season on there. So it's the PAC Rugby Show now. It's the PAC Rugby Show on Instagram. And on TikTok. I don't know if we've got Facebook. I don't think we're aiming for the 63-year-old boomer market. So we've got TikTok and Instagram and YouTube. Go on there, the PAC Rugby Show. Like, subscribe, follow all our shit, share all our shit, communicate with us. Let us know, as I said, if there's anyone out there, if there's anything out there you want us to discuss or you want us to get around, let us know. We'd love to help get around you guys and help grow the game here in Australia. So in the meantime, it's been an absolute privilege, as per usual, to come out. Dallin, Big Fat Das, Freeney, Zachy Boy, Tino and Tom on the ones and twos. Thank you so much. And in the meantime, enjoy the footy this weekend, and we'll see you for the rest of the season. Ciao. Yep.